I'm Gale Banks. I'm at AMSOIL in Superior, Wisconsin to learn everything about engine oil. And man, do I have some questions.
It's time for Speed School. We all use engine oil, but do we really know what's in the bottle? I called my friends at AMSOIL to see if they'd give me a tour and explain the science and chemistry. They said yes. I booked a flight, and this is the first day of my lubrication education.
Hi, Scott.
Good to see you, Gale.
Thank you.
Welcome to the AMSOIL Center.
Thank you.
You bet.
Now, you know, we're working on a turnkey engine program at Banks.
Yes, I am.
So I'm here to learn everything I can about engine oil. I figured you guys are the experts.
I think we can give you the lessons you're looking for.
All right.
But I think the place we should start is a history lesson to let you know where AMSOIL started, and let's take a look at that, and then we'll build on there as we walk through the facility.
Well, let's do this.
All right, sounds great. I think we really need to start from the beginning. Al Amatuzio, founder of this company, had a great idea. He was up flying the jets while he was in the military, and he said, hey, this works in a real cold climate, way up in the air.
Yes.
Well, he said it's kind of cold in his hometown. And he said, I think there's a real place for this product and people don't know it yet.
Yes.
So he went to work and he was formulating synthetic lubricants. And the process is he knew he had something really good.
Yes.
But everybody else hadn't heard of it. They called it fake oil at the time.
Because synthetic?
Because it was synthetic. It wasn't real oil, it was synthetic. It was made, it was manufactured, it was engineered.
Yes.
So he brought that back down. And he said, we need some credibility. So he sent this product off to the experts at Southwest Research Institute. This is the letter where that sample was submitted. And as a result, the American Petroleum Institute approved AMSOIL as the first synthetic lubricant to be run in a combustion engine
that
for the automotive industry.
That is huge.
It is. And how Al established AMSOIL as the first in synthetics.
Yes.
This API certification was the stamp of approval. And that took us to the next stage. And that next stage is production, distribution, and sales. And it started small. But this is kind of fun. Right over here is a pride and joy of Al Amatuzio. He refers to that as Big Red. That truck is maintained yet today. And he personally filled the bottles, packed them in cases, put them on the truck, and delivered them with that truck.
I'll be damned.
Al himself was introduced into the Lubricants Hall of Fame. He changed the industry. There wasn't a synthetic before, and now all the majors have one. They were followers, they were copycats, they understood that we knew something that they didn't.
Yes.
But we're still leading because we're still committing to doing it the best possible. But when we say firsts, we didn't only have the first API certified oil, we have many firsts. The first synthetic diesel oil, that should mean a lot to you, shouldn't it?
Yeah, I'm loving that.
All right, first synthetic racing oil. Turbocharged engines. It was the first oil designed specifically for that.
Yes.
And it's the first synthetic. It is
fantastic.
Whether it's two-stroke, whether it's marine, the list goes on and on. And I think it's a list of 29 firsts that allow us to say the first in synthetics.
When we started turbocharging back in the 60s, guys called them hair dryers. Banks and his hair dryers. If you're persistent and you continue to refine your art, which you guys do, then you get to where you are today.
If you think this is great, I'm going to blow your mind when you see the technology and the engineering that's put into making every drop of AMSOIL.
Let's follow the yellow brick road.
Let's go. Well, you're standing in the rail spur. And it's obviously named the indoor rail spur.
Yeah.
Do you realize how many people walk in here and say, why did you do that? There's a reason. There's 6 months of winter in Superior, Wisconsin. And can you imagine all the ice and the snow that's covering these pumps, that's in the rail that we would have to move every time it snowed?
Yes.
The employee safety, trying to wrestle these Anaconda hoses, big hoses, to get them up underneath there. And so we're protecting our employees. So these rail cars here, they're going to range in size. This one here is a dual compartment, so there's two different chemicals in there split down the middle. about 20,000 gallons total capacity.
Yes.
An average rail car is about 23,000, mm-hmm. But we got a jumbo on the other side over here that's 30,000 gallons.
I saw that one.
That's a bonus that because you get more gallons for the same dollars shipped shipped in.
Yeah.
So the process would be, let's take this, let's take that 30,000 gallon rail car.
Okay.
We're gonna go in, we're gonna take a sample. We're gonna take it up to the laboratory and test it. It'll be tested to the standard that was the very first raw material. It's mm-hmm. a very tight specification. As soon as it's accepted, we're gonna hook it up and unload it. And in under 4 hours, that rail car is ready to leave. We can do 6 rail cars in 4 hours.
Speaking of heating, do you ever have to heat the material?
Some of those raw materials are very thick. They would not be pulled out of there with a pump very effectively. Mm-hmm. Try taking a really thick malt through a straw. That's what you end up with here.
Yes.
You can't pump it through. So we actually can steam the rail car and bring it up to about 160 degrees in order to get that product to flow to be able to pump it through the system.
So this baby is 25,000 gallons. Look at the load limit. There's a number. Oh my God. That's very heavy.
Right now, we're in the heart of the blending area. This is the heart of the tank farm.
Yes.
There are 50 tanks in this area, a little over 1 million gallons of storage.
Oh my God.
Look up.
Oh yeah, look at this.
There's the automation. That's the valve and the valve control system. And as we walk through here, you'll be walking by over 2,100 valves, all pressure reducing valves so we can control the pressures mm-hmm. and make sure everything's processing. Some of the tanks are heated in order to make the pumpability there.
Yes.
Now imagine a pump that's here filled with a synthetic lubricant in the gearbox,
mm-hmm.
moving a synthetic lubricant. They do not mechanically fail.
Yes.
You might have an electrical problem with one someday, but we've never had a mechanical failure. So when you look at the technology here, the piggable systems, the ability to clean every line completely,
mm-hmm.
the design of the pump system, the recirculation, it gives us the ability to respond quickly to orders, be able to maintain the quality of the product.
Yes.
And we have eliminated any potential for cross-contamination by the design of the system.
So you send a pig through to clean.
Right.
Between products.
Between runs, between one product run to the next to leave a completely clean line behind it, even though we're putting a compatible product in the pipe the next time.
I got it. Do you make multiple passes with the pig?
2 passes every time.
So you go down and return.
And we go down and back, so it's very clean by the time it gets back.
Wow.
Let's go over here, and I think I can show you one of those pigs and
all
how
right.
that works.
Yes.
But you can see the complexity of the technology. There's over 250 miles of electrical wire doing the instrumentation.
Well, the one thing I like, just looking at the hard line here, just the way it's all arranged, bent.
It's well thought out, isn't
it? This is what you do when you're plumbing the brake lines on a hot rod.
It's the same.
I mean, this is absolutely square with the world. And that's, I love it.
I'm impressed that you see those details
because
the craftsmen made it that way and they didn't realize anybody would notice that.
I notice it.
You did?
Plumbing and wiring makes every job. And I mean, it makes this job, and this is a massive thing. But it's a big-ass hot rod. I think that's how I'm looking at it.
I like that analogy, a big-ass hot rod.
Yes,
that's what we're running here.
This thing is something special.
So this station right here is at the end of the line.
Yes.
And on this pipe, only passenger car motor oil tanks are attached to it.
Mm-hmm.
So as soon as we're done, let's do a 0W20 passenger car motor oil today. Mm-hmm. As soon as that one's done, we'll take one of the pigs. It's already in here, mm-hmm. I can tell because it's on the plunger.
Yep.
We'll put air pressure behind it. It will move through, long radius 90, so that it doesn't bend tight or get stuck.
And it is bendable.
It is bendable, but it will squeegee all of that product right over to the closed valve at the filler.
Yeah.
All the product will be going into the package. We'll close the valve, open it up, push the residual down to the other end, mm-hmm. collect it, and then let's bring it back and let's clean it one more time and park it right here.
So what you guys aren't fully appreciating yet is all the welds on the exterior where these bends are built into the system. You see the weld on the exterior, but if the weld's on the interior, it eats the pig. So
choose it up.
These were probably done with an inert gas like argon inside the pipe while they welded it.
Right. There's a butt weld mm-hmm. on the joint itself.
Yes.
completely clean on the inside, mm-hmm. and then the external weld for the string.
Yep.
Everyone.
Gotcha there. We're both excited about the same thing. Yeah. But it's really kind of an exciting opportunity to know 1.4 million gallons of product is in here, and it's going to meet all of our production needs.
Just this room.
1.4 million.
Oh my God.
It's amazing, isn't
it? So this family thing means a lot to us as well at Banks.
I bet it does.
You guys, 49 years in, second generation.
Second generation.
We're 63 in.
We got some catching up to
do. And we have the first generation. The first generation is talking to you. The second generation is mid-management.
Okay.
And the third generation, they're in their 20s, late teens. They're all learning.
It's important.
Yeah.
It's important. But the benefits of that is you've got the opportunity to say, let's make the right decisions for the business, not for the
long
shareholder.
Long term. Just like you said.
You've asked us about how we do this. We've got a human-machine interface that helps us interact with all of this technology here. You can see what Steve's doing here. They're adding some product over at the decant tank, and you can see on the left-hand side where it's going up. And
I see the weight.
The weight's going
and
up.
And the volume.
And the volume is increasing. They're going to need just a little bit more to top it off to get the right recipe in there.
So what's the units of volume here?
That would come in gallons. It's a translation because
gallons.
We know the density.
5 gallons. Got it.
Or 861 pounds.
Yes.
That's what they're targeting.
Yes.
So they'll have to get one more drum to put in the last 60 pounds, mm-hmm. and then that additive will be complete. And what we're looking at over here is they're blending our 10W30 Signature Series product, ATM, and this tank right here is filling up. Right now, there's 7,333 gallons in that tank.
Oh, man.
As soon as they finish the decant filling and ensure the weight's there, that'll be pumped in. Mm-hmm. The final base oil will be pumped in behind it, pig over to the tank, and that blend will be complete. Perfect timing.
Yeah.
They're right in the middle of a blend. They're going to have to add this drum stock with that secret sauce in the blend.
Gotcha.
So what they're doing is they're lining it up over the decant tank, and that way they can get a very accurate dose on the weight. That decant tank is on load cells on the base. So it's taking the degree of accuracy up a notch by making sure we're not just estimating the gallons, we're actually getting the
weighing
weight.
It.
Yes.
Yes. So this is decanting like fine wine.
Like fine wine. That's exactly what's happening. So with that, after it's been set, they've established the weight of the product, then it'll be integrated into our simultaneous meter blending. So that's just staging it in order to finish the blend.
Where does the blend happen?
Not here, but here.
Right behind you.
Yeah. So right behind you here, you know what a heat exchanger is, right?
Yes, I sure do.
I thought you might. So overhead piping will bring in the primary base oil. It'll be pumped through this heat exchanger and heated to roughly 180 degrees.
Yes.
It'll be coming through at about 150 gallons per minute. So that's the carrier.
Yes.
Then the additives will be pumped in line, simultaneously metering them into the process at a very high degree of accuracy.
So there's precision metering pumps?
Precision metering pumps,
yes.
Air eliminators, everything we can to get a very high accurate dose into every one of the additives in the product. So with that, then that hot oil will pick up the other ones. It'll get to the end, be about 200 gallons a minute. It will pick it up. It's already mixing in the pipe. It'll go up, over, to the tank, to that closed valve, into the tank. It's accumulating 200 gallons a minute.
Yes.
It'll start recirculating and mixing. When the last product comes out, we talked about the pig. It will push every drop into that blend.
Yes.
Valve will close. This one will open. It'll clean that line out, circulate for 15 minutes, go to the lab, and we're ready to package.
So the mixing process is in it, recycling through the system?
It's circulating the product from the pump through the process through an eductor that's creating a lot of turbulence in the tank.
All right, that was my question.
The eductor is causing the turbulence.
Yes, probably 90% or 95% of the blending action happens in the eductor.
It happens in the tank itself. There's some happening in the pipe, but majority of it's happening in the tank through the eductor where it's recirculating in the system.
It looks like there's three decant tanks. What's going on here?
Well, that's the benefit of having a design system to be able to handle capacity, because they could be doing this blend of 10W30 Signature Series motor oil.
Okay.
They could be doing a transmission fluid in the next one at the same time, mm-hmm. and be doing a fuel additive in the next one and doing three blends simultaneously.
Exactly. I love it. Each blending station is dedicated to a family.
It's dedicated to the family so that the cross-contamination cannot occur.
Yes.
In addition to the cleaning of the system, the pigging of the system, the flushing, in order to ensure purity of every blend.
I'm with you.
From beginning to end.
Love it. You guys are the masters of custom blends. It seems like application-specific blends are your art form.
That's exactly what's happening here.
Yeah.
It's the way we put them together is different than the others. This is where it really gets exciting, because the speed really picks up here.
Yes,
when we're
does.
Filling our quarts, the key is we got to get those empty bottles on there as fast as the filler can fill them. And that's what's happening here in the unscrambler.
It must fill at an alarming rate. My God, look at this.
There's just a lot of chaos in there, but they're coming out like they're supposed to. So I bet you're wondering, how fast are these running?
Exactly.
They're running right now at 185 bottles per minute.
And you guys are going for 200?
We're going for 200. Take a look, 24 head filler.
Mm-hmm.
What it's doing is taking the bottle and measuring every bottle weight. So it tells us how much variation there is in the bottle weight.
Oh my God.
Then it tears that out to zero and puts the right amount of fluid in every time.
So it weighs the empty bottle.
It weighs the empty bottle,
yes.
Takes that to zero, then puts the right amount of fluid in, so every product is within 0.8 grams of each other between bottles.
0.8 gram.
0.8 gram.
Wow.
That's how accurate it is.
Yes. So this is the fill.
That is the fill.
All right.
So the empty bottle's going in, and there's a scale at the bottom. So those first two stations, it's weighing, and it starts filling at the third position.
Yes. Fantastic.
And then it finishes filling before it comes around, and then a vacuum pulls any drip back up into there so we don't have any drips on the bottle.
Yes. Keeps the bottles clean.
Then it hands it off to another indexing wheel and feeds it into the capper. And again, those are rotary chuck cappers. The rotary chuck capper has a built-in clutch so that the torque is the same on every cap.
Got it.
So I think this will be kind of fun. There's a label, zero.
It's 74.4, 75.4, 73.6.
Now, you're seeing variability here.
Yeah.
That's not in the oil. That's in the bottle weight.
Got it. Yes.
So I told you it's 0.8.
Yeah, we don't know the tear weight of the bottle.
Exactly.
Exactly.
So you're seeing a little more variation here, but the material in itself is all right on the money. You could pull this, slide it in, and it'll actually be that bottle there, and it will send it to the laboratory.
Got it. So when you first start this line, you pull a sample, put it in one of these sample bottles, put it in a vacuum transport, and send it to the lab upstairs.
Right. What's amazing is they used to take that and carry it to the lab and deliver it,
yeah.
and then walk back and finish setting up. Just by taking that, putting it in, sending it over, and continuing to set up, we took 5 minutes off our changeover and helped us set that uptime record.
Oh, I got it. Beautiful.
Today, they're just running the 5W40 diesel oil in our maximum duty series, and they're moving this through. They got the back label, the front label, and they'll move through the system, and then the operator there is watching the alignment to make sure it's not crooked in the process.
Yes.
But they've also got cameras inspecting the cap, measuring the distance between the shoulder and the cap, and making sure it's down tight, as well as labels. They get an alarm if one of the labels would miss, if for some reason there would be a misfire.
Got it. You gotta love this. You absolutely have to love this. This is where I live, diesel oil.
This is where you live, the diesel oil. And I don't
wonderful.
Know if you knew this, but we ran it just for you.
Oh my God.
Well, I'm gonna be honest. It was very convenient. We needed this product because it's selling so well, and it just worked out that you were here today.
It's perfect.
Now let's take a look at the additive line.
All right.
Joel here is busy feeding the bottles into the filler so that we can run the process through. And he's running this upper cylinder lube product through. Mm-hmm. And you can see the challenge, be able to run this down the line without it tipping over when it's that small. Yeah. That's why we have the puck handling system to move through.
Got it.
This bottle also is designed from the very beginning. It's got some really unique features to keep it from getting caught in the fuel tank when you pour this in, mm-hmm. so you can actually get it back out. And that's why we have to do this on every piece of our process. Let's follow this process through and see what's happening.
All right. He's faster than the machine.
So it's kind of fun when you watch a packaging line run through. If you've never seen it before, it's hard to determine, you know, all the pieces that go into getting that accurately filled, accurately capped in a carton and ready for the customer.
And a label.
And not to mention a label on it, wrap it around and get it straight.
Yes.
So as you can see, the pucks will lead the product right in under the fill heads.
Yes.
We've got an 8-head filler where 8 will be positioned underneath. It will fill to the accurate level, cycle through and advance. Mm-hmm. So now the product will move forward. They'll pick up the puck, mm-hmm. position it under the rotary chuck capper. The rotary chuck capper has a built-in clutch. So what it'll do is it'll put it down to the exact torque.
Got it.
And that's important because if you over-torque or under-torque, it won't last the shipping up to the use. Mm-hmm. It may leak. So that's where the rotary chuck capper style design is the best design
that
there is.
That is very cool. Here they come down.
You can hear them when it's turning. You can hear when it breaks loose. And so at that point, it's tight. And that little click is where it's breaking loose.
Got it.
Then as we're moving forward, it has a cap on it. It needs to heat seal. Mm-hmm. So the seal will be bound to it. And then it'll pull this out and drop the puck out to go pick up another bottle at the other end.
Got it.
Now we have the challenge of labeling it.
Are we counting here? Is this a...
It's checking the cap. This is a camera checking to make sure the cap is on straight and is fully down into position.
I got it.
So this allows us not to have an operator standing here watching that.
Yes.
But it assures proper application.
And there goes the puck.
It's making its return trip back to the other end.
De-pucked right here.
So that gives us full traceability right back to the raw materials that were received in the laboratory.
This has to do with your ISO certification.
It does.
Right here. This is.
But don't you have confidence that we could track this back to every raw material that was put into it and
Absolutely. The
packaging day? It gives us that full
Absolutely.
Visibility. So now it is spacing the product so it can go through the labeler.
Mm-hmm.
Because if you go too close, it tries to put two of them, label them together.
See the process. Here come the labels off of the reel.
It's on straight.
Yep.
Moving through. Wrapped nice and tight with no wrinkles.
Yes. Beautiful Perfect. Job. Beautiful job.
We just came off the packaging line and followed that forklift here into our central warehouse. What's in here is over 1,000 different products that we produce in this facility. 1,000 different products.
Oh my God. My God.
So when we have 1,000 different products, we got to get them somewhere.
Mm-hmm.
And we have a great distribution network throughout North America with 13 locations. And from those locations, we can reach 89% of the U.S. population in one day. That's 99% amazing. In 2 days. One of the details here that most people don't know is we're going to turn this inventory 18 times this year. Are you impressed?
I'm trying for 4 in my warehouse. So yeah, I'm impressed.
Well, you got some improvement opportunity there.
Yeah, absolutely. I got a long ways to go.
So do you have any questions?
Where is that diesel oil we were looking at?
Oh, it's right here. That's what you were looking for. We were producing it today. Yeah, it's good stuff. Security.